Welcome to Resurrection Sunday. Father, we thank you for this week in history. That today we can remember what you have accomplished through this week in history. For Father, you not only gave your Son to be mocked and crucified, but Father, you raised him from the dead. And he's alive today. And he's alive in us. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity to come and to celebrate what you have done for us. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I told Terry this morning, I was sitting at the table crying, and I said, I hope I could get all of this out, but I didn't. I spent a lot of time this week reflecting on this week in the life of our Savior. This morning, I want to attempt, things may be a little bit hodgepodge, but I want to attempt to do three things this morning. First of all, to look at this week and the things that transpired prior to the resurrection, then look at the resurrection, and then look at the resurrection power that's available to you and I today. So those three things I want to attempt to accomplish this morning. Jesus went through, in this week in history, a period of triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Then his arrest, the forsaking of all of his disciples, those that he loved, those that he had spent 3 years ministering to and teaching and training, they all forsook him. Peter denied him. He went through the mockery of a trial. Everything in it was illegal. And then he was crucified, beaten beyond recognition, and then hung on a cross. And 3 days later, to rise from the dead by God. There's a lot of scripture this morning, and I'm just going to let the Word of God speak, and not a lot else. Terry said this morning, said, you sure got a lot of scripture for John to put in the machine. I said, well, that's about all I'm going to say is what the Word of God says. We're going to begin this morning because all of this was predicted hundreds of years before. And the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 53 states this: Who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form nor comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men. Just think of these things as you think of the week in history. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Body, mind, and soul. If you notice back in those verses before we go on, there are 5 hours. Our sorrows, our griefs, our sorrows, our transgressions, our iniquities, and our peace was upon him. 5 hours. H-O-U-R-S, not H-O-U-R-S. 5 hours. Five in the scripture represents grace. It was by God's grace that all of this took place. It continues on. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, the judgment hall, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was stricken. And they made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death. The rich at his death. Because he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he has poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered with the transgressors, the two criminals. And he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. That scripture was written many years, many, many years before Jesus Christ ever came on the face of the earth. 1 Peter 2, verses 21 through 24. For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps, who committed no sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth, who when he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but committed himself to him who judges righteously. who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sin, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. You see, Jesus Christ was tried, convicted as a criminal, and crucified on a cross, not for anything he did, but for us. There's a verse of scripture that I want us to go to. In Matthew. Sorry, I'm using multiple devices this morning. And I want us to spend a moment on this verse, because I think we've all been where Jesus was. Matthew 27, verses 45 and 46. Now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness over all the land. And about the ninth hour, about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," that is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" I got an email Friday. And this is why I've entered this in today's message. This email is from the son of John Bevere. In one of his books and in one of his messages, a young man who was raised in church, his dad is world famous. And yet he went through a 5-year period of his life when he felt God had forsaken him. He knew he was born again. He knew that he had Christ in him, but yet he felt forsaken. He says, "Dear Lester," sorry, that's my first name. "On this Good Friday, we remember. In Matthew 27, 46, we read, about 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?' We struggle with the idea that Jesus could let out such a prayer. So we developed different theories to cleanse the messiness of that moment. But at some point, these efforts are a mistake. Maybe we should sit with attention and see what Scripture and Spirit can offer us. First of all, have you ever felt at some point in your life that God had just forgotten you? And if we're human, we've been through that experience. We have faced the experience that, God, where are you? It may be a death. It may be the loss of jobs. It may be health. It could be any number of things. But all of a sudden we realize, my God, why have you forsaken me? We've all experienced this at some point in our life. if not once, many times. That we've been to that point in our life that even though we know God is there, we still cry out, God, where are you? Psalm 22, 1 through 24. David went through this experience. And he cries out, and this is also a prophecy, but this was a personal experience too. Because David, many times in his life, David was a very complex person. And he says in verse 1, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me and from the words of my groaning? David was a man after God's own heart. But yet he cried, God, where are you? Oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but you don't hear. And in the night season, and I'm not silent. But you're holy, enthroned in the praises of Israel. He knows that God exists. He knows that God is there. But God, you're not. Where are you in my life? Our fathers trusted in you. They trusted and you delivered them. They cried to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not ashamed. But I'm a worm and no man, a reproach of men and despised by the people. All those who see me ridicule me. They shoot out the lip. They shake the head saying, he trusted in the Lord. Let him rescue him. Let him deliver him since he delights in him. But you are he who took me out of my womb. You made me trust while on my mother's breast. I was cast upon you from birth. From my mother's womb you have been my God. Be not far from me, for my trouble is near. For there is none to help. Many bulls have surrounded me. This is David's life, and it's also the life of Jesus Christ. Many bulls have surrounded me. Strong bulls of Bashan have encircled me. They gape at me with their mouths like a raging and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue clings to my jaws. You see how this reveals Jesus Christ? You have brought me to the dust of death, for dogs have surrounded me. The congregation of the wicked have enclosed me. They have pierced my hands and feet. I count all my bones. They stare and look at me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far from me. O my strength, hasten to help me. Deliver me from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth and from the horns of the wild oxen. You have answered me. I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, all you descendants of Jacob, glorify him and fear him, all you offspring of Israel. Verse 24, a sound of triumph. For he has not despised or abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, nor has he hidden his face from him. But when he cried out to him, he heard. Do you think for one moment that God abandoned his son on the cross? You see, Jesus Christ had to face the same things that we face in order to be our full Redeemer. He had to feel the rejection of God. He had prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, spent all night in prayer. But yet his disciples had forsaken him. Everyone that he loved had forsaken him. And now as he's hanging on the cross, he has this desperation. God, where are you? But you see, it was God's will that he go through this, that he feel the pains of rejection completely to where he felt like God had rejected him. If the Word of God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you, do you think for one moment that God forsook his only begotten Son? It was that feeling inside that God has left me. Arden goes on to say, the author of Hebrews claims that it was through pain, suffering, and ultimately death that Jesus fully entered the human experience. And for that reason, he can sympathize with us when we're tempted. In Hebrews 2, verses 14 through 18, it says, inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all of their lifetime subject to bondage. For indeed, he does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. Therefore, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For that he himself has suffered, being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. The one who lived in perfect union with the Father, the one who only did what he saw the Father doing, joined his voice to the universal human cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? When our Savior prayed these words, he was quoting Psalm 22. But you see, all the ends of the earth in the last verse shall return and remember the Lord. He has not forsaken us. You see, Jesus Christ had to feel forsaken because sometimes we feel forsaken by God, and he had to go through that same experience. He had to enter that period of, where are you, God? But yet God hadn't left him. 3 days later, God raised him from the dead. Now let's look for briefly a moment at the resurrection. Because the grave is not the end. Matthew 28, 1 through 7. Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, and he says this to you and me, don't be afraid. For I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. It's not over. He's not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And indeed, he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. Jesus was in the grave 3 days and three nights. And sometime after 6 PM on the Sabbath day, he rose from the dead. He was risen when they got there. He was already risen. Mark 16, verses 1 through 7. Now when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices that they might come and anoint him. Very early in the morning on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. And they said among themselves, who's going to roll away the stone? It was massive. But when they looked up, they saw the stone had been rolled away, for it was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a long white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, don't be alarmed. Don't be afraid. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him. And don't just stop there. Go tell his disciples that he's risen. And Peter. Because Peter had denied him, he wanted to make sure that Peter knew. And then in John 20, verses 1 through 9, we're going to skip the section in Luke because all four Gospels record it. John 20, 1 through 9 gives us a little bit more information. Now, the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and the other disciple whom Jesus loved. John was writing that. Whom Jesus loved and said to them, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. Peter therefore went out and the other disciple and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloths. He didn't see a body. He saw the linen cloths just as he was wrapped, lying there, untouched, but the body was gone. Yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came. Oh, Simon runs to everything. Following him and went into the tomb and saw the linen clothes lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the scripture, they forgot, they could not remember that he must rise again from the dead. There's the records. All four Gospels record that Jesus Christ rose from the grave. Then we find in Acts 1, verse 3, the former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive, after his suffering, by many infallible proofs. Many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days. It wasn't just a happen chance. It wasn't just one or two. By 40 days and speaking seen by them and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Can you imagine in the 40 days what Jesus fed to his disciples in that 40 days? One other section. For I delivered in 1 Corinthians 15, 3 through 8. For I delivered first of all, that which I received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12, and after that he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remained to the present. So you could go to over 500 and ask them. Some of them have fallen asleep. After that he was seen by James, then by all the apostles. Then last of all, he was seen by me also, Paul, as one born out of due time. So the resurrection of the dead by Jesus Christ was real. It was witnessed for 40 days. Many people saw him. So there's proof. The next thing is the power available to you and I. Because if Jesus Christ had just been raised from the dead, and that was the end, that would be a sad story. But that power of that resurrection is available to you and I today. Romans 6, 4 through 11. Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. He has given us the power to walk in newness of life by that resurrection. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. Verse 11, likewise you also reckon yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. We have the power of the resurrection. Ephesians 1, 18 through 23. This is Paul's prayer. That the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of his glory in his inheritance in the saints. Let's stop right there. We read that the wrong way oftentimes. It says, the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. God counts it all joy for us to be his children. He is thankful that we are his inheritance. You see, it's the hope of his calling, the riches of the glory of his inheritance in us. He is joyful over inheriting you and me. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but is also in that which is to come. Where is that power? Where is the source of that power? It's in Christ when he raised him from the dead. It is the power of God in Christ when he raised him from the dead. And he has put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. In Philippians 3:10, Paul states this, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. To know the power of his resurrection, that power is resident in you and me. and the fellowship of his sufferings, to be conformed to his sufferings, to suffer what he suffered, to completely deny self, being conformed to his death. 1 Peter 1:3-9. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away. Four things. It's an inheritance that's incorruptible, undefiled, doesn't fade away. It's not like a red shirt that fades away in the sun. And it's reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it be tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom, having not seen, you love. Though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. You see, we may have to go through those times of saying, God, where are you? But the resurrection power of God says, I'm here. I'm in you. 1 Peter 1, or 18, verses 18 through 21 of 1 Peter 1. Knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, like silver or gold, from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. And the final thing is that our hope is not for now. It's for the future as well. Because he has given us power. We have that same power that rose Jesus from the grave, living inside of us. But it's a hope now, and it's a hope for the future. 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 13 through 18. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, God will bring those with him those who fall or who are asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall be raised first. You see, so whether we're dead or alive, when he returns, we're going to be with him. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. The power of the resurrection gives us hope now, that God has not forsaken us, that God is still here. He is still on the throne. He still lives, and He still lives with inside us. And He is with us now, and He will gather us together, and we will be with Him forever. Comfort one another with those words. Amen. In light of all of this, we want to celebrate communion this morning. Because of all that Jesus Christ has accomplished. Because it's by His death that our sin is paid. It's by His broken body and His shed blood that we're redeemed. And it's by His resurrection that we can live forever and have eternal hope. So this morning I want to read from 1 Corinthians 11. Remembering the Last Supper before He was crucified. And Paul says, "For I received from the Lord that which also I delivered to you, which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is My body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of Me.' In the same manner, He also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in My blood.'" Not the blood of animals, but in My blood. "This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till He comes." So, He took bread. And He broke it. And He blessed it. Father, thank You for what You have done through Your Son. Father, we thank You for the broken body of Jesus Christ. That, Father, His suffering was far more than a physical suffering, because He bore our sin on the cross. He not only bore the physical agony and the broken body, but He bore the sins of the world. Father, thank You for that broken body. And then He gave it to His disciples. Likewise, also, He took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood. This do as often as you do it in remembrance of Me." And He blessed the cup. "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till He comes." So, Father, we thank You for that shed blood. Thank You, Father, that You poured out your life. You poured out your blood. As the spear was pierced into your son's side, Father, it poured out water and blood. Thank you, Father, for that shed blood, for the remission of our sin. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. If you will come and take and break a piece, we'll dip it in the cup. John, could you play that closing song now? You have given us freedom. You see, Paul said, as we partook of communion, he said, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Then he rose. John, would you close us out in prayer?
Thank you, God, for showing us how you won the victory. And Lord, help us never to cheapen the experience you've gone through. Hold that in reverence. To treasure that, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, that you have purchased our victory and our freedom, Lord, with your blood. And Lord, help us live the way you want us to live. Victorious life, showing the resurrected Christ in us to be a light to shine to our communities. We thank you, Lord, for the rest of this day as we go our separate ways. Let your glory, let your light, let your love flow through us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. We've got just a couple of announcements to make. First of all, our Wednesday night service will be held at the new location. That location, for those of you who may be watching online or are not here this morning, that location is 201 North Monroe Street here in Beeville. That location for all of the local people is directly across from the vineyard. So if you know where the vineyard is, you can find the building. It's a red building on the corner. Can't miss it. But we will hold our first service there on Wednesday evening. Okay, you got a map there? Okay. So we will have our first service there Wednesday evening. We still have some finished work to do. We were over there yesterday and got one TV hung. And we got the other one almost hung. So we'll be set up for Sunday. It's 6:30. Oh, April the 7th. Okay, the Sunday. Okay. I wasn't watching the screen. For those of y'all, Ralph, I didn't know his last name until a couple of days ago. Shoop is his last name. Ralph and Mary have come here. He's in the hospital. He's in ICU. I talked to Mary about an hour ago, but John and I are going to go visit. She said that he could have company. I didn't know you could have company in ICU, but so we're going to go visit with him in a little bit. His blood sugar went crazy on him, and he's back in ICU. But we do need to keep them in prayer, him and Mary. Mary is on twice a day home care, so they haven't been able to come because she's there. She has care twice a day, and he didn't want to try to come by himself. So we need to keep them in prayer. The Connect cards are out front. I don't think we have anybody new today. For your giving, if you don't have your offering today, you could go to your phone and text 73256 and text to give and fill in the amount. Okay? If there's no other announcements, let's just stand and we're dismissed.